The votes are in, the ballots have been counted, and America has spoken.
And fundamentally, this year was a good year for Republicans going in.
Midterm election coverage starts right now on LCTV News.
Good evening. I'm Michaela Hesse alongside Allison Wong. America made some big changes last night.
One of the biggest was right here in Iowa as the state elected Republican Joni Ernst to the U.S. Senate to replace retiring Democratic Senator Tom Harkin. With more on that historic race, here's Maria Adolphs.
Michaela and Allison, in the days and weeks leading up to the election, pundits and polls were saying this race was too close to call. But as results came in, it became clear that Iowa was going to swing red for the first time in 30 years.
They ignore problems, hoping they'll go away. But you know what? ISIS isn't just going to go away.
I leave here tonight filled with hope and optimism.
Final numbers from the Iowa Secretary of State show Ernst with 52% of the vote. Compare that to the Democrat Bruce Braley's 43%. That's a 9-point gap, much larger than the 1 to 2 points most polls predicted.
She did very well across the state. That's one of the amazing things if you look at it.
Although Braley won here in Dubuque County, Ernst carried the majority of the state.
We are heading to Washington. And we are going to make them squeal.
Ernst will head to Washington as the first female senator from Iowa.
Iowa's first congressional district also switched from blue to red. Braley gave up his seat to run for Senate, so the race was on between Democrat Pat Murphy and Republican Rod Blum. The latest Loras College poll showed Blum with a slight edge. That proved true late last night as Murphy conceded.
The bottom line is the people in the first district decided they wanted to go a different direction. And so they have. And that's life.
As I've been saying when I campaigned with Joni, today, Tuesday, November 4th, is not about Joni Ernst. It's not about Rod Blum. This is about the future direction of the United States of America.
The first district hasn't elected a Republican to its seat since 2004. If you look at the map here, three of the four districts in Iowa now hold Republican seats in the House.
Now to the race for governor. Here's a roundup of results from the three states in our area. Iowa sticks with what they know, re-electing Republican Terry Branstad for a sixth term. That makes him the longest serving governor in U.S. history. Across the river in Illinois, Bruce Rauner defeated incumbent Pat Quinn to turn Illinois red. And finally, to the Badger State. After a heated recall election in 2012, the people of Wisconsin re-elect Republican Governor Scott Walker to a second term.
With wins in Iowa and six other states, Republicans have taken control of the U.S. Senate. Political experts say it's a big shift, but not necessarily a surprising one.
President Obama's second term. He's not particularly popular. And his party got trounced in the polls.
The Dubuque County Auditor's Office is reporting average voter turnout for the elections. Just over 54% of eligible voters cast ballots yesterday. That's up slightly from the 53% who turned out in 2012. Although they aren't old enough to officially vote, local students were still able to cast a ballot in the statewide mock election. At Bellevue High School, students voted while learning about the current issues surrounding this election. Almost 70 schools across Iowa participated in the mock election.
If you voted yesterday, you might have shared the fact with your Facebook friends via the I'm a Voter app. But the app might be more than a fun way to let your friends know you fulfilled your civic duty. A team of scientists at the University of California, San Diego, found that users who saw their Facebook friends had voted were 0.39% more likely to do the same. That small increase added up an additional 340,000 votes to be cast in the 2012 elections. No numbers have been released about the app's impact yesterday.
In honor of midterm elections, we have a political-themed trivia question tonight. Email us the correct answer at lctv@loras.edu or tweet it to us at lctv_news, and you could score some free frozen yogurt.
Here's the question. President Barack Obama is a Democrat. Before Obama, who was the last Democrat to inhabit the White House? Is it A, George W. Bush, B, George H.W. Bush, C, Ronald Reagan, or D, Bill Clinton? Get those guesses in, and we will reveal the answer and the winner at the end of the show.
Bad looks.
Still ahead on LCTV News.
Bad looks, I get them all the time because I'm homeless.
What homelessness looks like in Dubuque and how you can help.
And you're looking live at the Rock Bowl, where the men's soccer team is preparing for the Iowa Conference semifinals. Stay tuned for a preview of the match.
Hey, Travis.
Get some friends, loser.
Thank you.
you all right, man?
Lean on me.
Thanks.
When you're not strong, and I'll be
character. Pass it on.
I'll help you carry.
A message from the Foundation for a Better Life.
The Dubuque County Sheriff's Department is looking for suspects in a string of robberies in the southeast part of the county. Residents in the Old Davenport Road and Schuler Heights area are saying suspects have entered unlocked vehicles and homes, taking cash, electronics, and hunting equipment. Deputies are reminding residents to lock their doors and report any suspicious activity as soon as possible.
November is Homelessness Awareness Month, and organizations in Dubuque are working to bring light to the issue by informing the public on ways to help. As I worked on this story, I quickly realized that homelessness doesn't always look the way that you expect it to.
I grew up across the river in East Dubuque. Family moved about 6 years ago over to Dubuque.
Jordan Zimmerman's childhood wasn't really unusual.
My parents divorced when I was 13. I lived with my mom for about a year or two, then decided to switch it up, went and moved in with my dad.
But things changed when he turned 18.
The day I graduated high school, he basically said, time to figure it out, and kicked me out.
Just 21 years old, Jordan has been homeless for over 3 years.
I'm still struggling.
He is just one representation of the many faces of homelessness.
The population ranges from single men, single women. It ranges in all different ages. There are college students that are homeless. People with formal educations that are homeless.
With so many faces of homelessness, it can be hard to see.
Dubuque does a really good job of hiding the homeless population. Yes, we do have homeless people here, and we do have people that are really in need.
If you see someone who is homeless and you aren't sure what to do, there is one easy way to help.
Call 211. 211 has a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week homeless hotline. There's a case manager on the other end of the phone that can help find them shelter any time of the day, any day of the year.
Connecting a homeless person to resources can make all the difference.
I see myself getting a job and getting an apartment with Project Concerns help, and maybe going back to school.
If you're interested in better understanding what it's like to be homeless or living in poverty, attend the Poverty Simulation next Thursday at St. Mary's Church. You can find details about this eye-opening event on mydohawk.com.
Dubuque health officials are taking steps to be prepared if Ebola reaches the tri-states. The virus has killed over 5,000 people in West Africa this year. It reached the U.S. at the end of September, with the CDC reporting 3 cases in Texas and 1 in New York. Ebola has not been seen in the Midwest, but local hospitals are reviewing protocol as a precaution.
We would rather be prepared and have everything collect dust than to not be prepared and have a situation on hand.
One Ebola patient in the U.S. has died. 2 others have been treated and released. The 4th remains in isolation.
Dubuque citizens are looking for ways to revitalize a historic church. St. Mary's has stood tall on the corner of 15th and White Street for more than 150 years. The parish closed its doors in 2010. Since then, groups have been working to repurpose the area known as St. Mary's Campus. Some of the buildings will be turned into apartments, but there's no clear plan on what to do with the sanctuary itself.
I said I'd like to see it become a community center, but of some sort, you know, where it's back with the people, because I didn't want to see it torn down.
Leaders of the Revitalization Project hosted a series of brainstorming sessions with the community last week. Preliminary plans could be released next month. The mother of one of the children killed in the Sandy Hook shooting shares her story at Loras College. Nicole Hockley lost her 6-year-old son Dylan nearly 2 years ago. He was one of the 20 children killed in the deadliest grade school shooting in U.S. history. Hockley came to Loras to talk about Sandy Hook Promise, an organization working to raise awareness of mental health and gun responsibility.
We often say at Sandy Hook Promise, what if the best way to start talking about gun violence is to stop talking about the gun?
After her presentation, Hockley answered questions from the audience about gun violence and what to do to help their community.
To pay or not to pay? That is the question with internships. Just 2 weeks ago, NBC Universal settled a $6.4 million class action lawsuit for not paying their interns. The case made me curious. What does the law say? Should you be getting paid for your internship? That's the question I set out to answer this week.
We just started decorating for Christmas.
Emily Mast is one of the growing number of students with a paid internship.
I would have done it even if I didn't have work study money, because it's a great opportunity to learn about things that you can't learn about in the classroom.
Fewer for-profit organizations having unpaid internships because there's been a lot of controversy over the last few years.
As the economy declined, many for-profit companies moved away from paid internships, but they still found interns because students were willing to gain experience even if they didn't earn money.
For some internships, the value of $10 an hour is meaningless when you consider the value of what they got out of the experience.
Do I want to go here where I can make money for a summer, or do I want to go here where, you know, I'm not going to get paid, but that's going to further me?
Although unpaid internships are common, they aren't always legal. The Fair Labor Standards Act requires for-profit organizations to pay interns who, quote, qualify as employees rather than trainees, end quote. Nonprofits are not required to pay interns, and there are some cases where for-profits don't have to pay, but they must meet specific criteria about the internship environment and the work the intern is doing.
While I understand the unpaid for nonprofit, I don't understand if there is an organization that's for-profit that's not paying.
It's kind of a supply and demand thing. If there's an internship that somebody really wants because that's the only way that they can break into that industry, and for them to do that, it's going to be, okay, I have to put in my time as an unpaid intern. It's kind of the way the world works.
Whether paid or unpaid, it's no doubt. Internships pay off in the end.
Being in the setting that you want to spend the rest of your life working at is very different than you would ever get, like, in the classroom.
In Dubuque, Michaela Hasse, LCTV News.
That's really interesting, Michaela. I mean, it really makes me like want to think before I get an internship.
Yeah, definitely. You need to be aware as a college student about the laws that are out there regarding internships before going on your college search.
Definitely. Well, thank you for that. Alrighty, well, let's get over to Dimitri with what's happening with sports.
Well, Allison, it's conference tournament time for soccer. In about 15 minutes, the Duhawks will be looking to defend their conference title for the fifth year in a row. And we dive headfirst in the pool with the swim teams. Sports Shorts is right after this.
I find inspiration all around me, from those that push me to think and to grow, to move forward, because to stand still is to fall behind. That's not my plan. I'm just getting started. Now, just watch where I'll go. Loras College. Affordable, challenging, life-changing.
Let's jump straight to that soccer semifinal match. Kyle Jacobs and Joel Schmidt are in the Rock Bowl getting ready to cover the game. What can we expect to see tonight, guys?
An inner-city matchup between the University of Dubuque and Loras College always has a lot of intensity, but there's a little extra intensity tonight, Joel, with it being postseason conference tournament matchup. What should we expect to see from both of these teams?
Well, the last time they played October 1st here in the Rock Bowl, there was one goal scored. The Spartans kicked into their own net, giving the Duhawks the 1-0 victory, so we'll see which team can limit their mistakes tonight. These are two evenly matched teams that love to play with a lot of high energy and quick-paced action, so we'll see who can come out on top and play on Saturday for the Iowa Conference Championship.
Game starts at 7 o'clock, and so at the conclusion of LCTV News, come on over and join us here in the Rock Bowl, or you can tune in to Duhawks.com/live. Joel and I will be on the call for tonight's game. We'll have a great matchup here between these two teams. Back to you in the studio, Dimitri.
The women's soccer team also began their postseason in the comfort of home. They welcomed the 6-seeded Luther Norse to Rock Bowl Saturday night. Katie Truesdale continued her scoring binge, her first goal coming just 4 minutes into the game. She shoots another goal and Luther goalie cannot hold on to it. Duhawks up 2-0. The Norse tied things up going into second half. Claire Murphy gives the Duhawks the 3-2 lead as she knocks this one in. But the Norse come back. Ellie Buns sneaks one inside the left post, and they're all tied up at 3. So we go overtime. In the extra period, it's Buns again. The golden goal in the 97th minute ends the Duhawks season.
We actually outplayed them pretty well. You know, the mistakes we made were in front of our own goal, and it cost us some what I would call soft goals.
Duhawks finished the season 11-8. The Duhawks swimming hosted their first home meet on Friday at San Jose Pool. The women dive off strong in the 200-yard freestyle. First-year Kim Bro takes the win by a full 7 seconds against Cope. Heading over to the men's 50-yard freestyle, sophomore Ike Casey kicks it into gear, taking first place. Later in the meet, the women's 500 freestyle takes a suspenseful turn as Elise Amo battles against Ko in the last moments of the race. Amo steals the win, beating Ko by just 0.2 of a second. The men's 200 IM was an easy victory for junior Greg Cormier as he finishes with a time of 2 minutes and 13 seconds.
We're working hard.
And we're taking it day by day, practice by practice, and we're looking for our main goal is the end of the year at Liberals. We want to do really well at Liberals. And I think with the times that we're pulling off now, we got a good shot.
Both teams walk away victorious. The women finish with a score of 112-105, while the men sweep away Co. 151-50. Two Hawks return to the pool in Rock Island this Friday. The Spartans from the University of Dubuque ventured down the boulevard Saturday to play some football. The Spartans hit the stride right away, reaching the end zone on just their second possession. The Duhawks try to even out the score as Brian Herman recovers a muff punt on the Spartan 31-yard line, but the touchdown attempt is intercepted. Loris gets on the board in the second quarter when Calvin Smith smashes through the Spartan defense. UD has the 14-7 lead at the half. Loris starts the third quarter with a strong drive, but the wind goes out of their sails within a forced fumble. It's all Spartans from here on out. Final score 34-7, and UD keeps the key to the city. The Duhawks will host their final home game Saturday against Luther. The men's cross-country team ended the season on a high note, claiming their first IIAC title since 2011. Ty Whitman, San Juan, and Steve Lauren finished 3rd, 4th, and 5th respectively, giving the team enough points to edge out Central for the title. The men will take a 2-week break before preparing for the NCAA Division III Regional Championship in Pella on November 15th. The Dubuque Fighting Saints welcome to the Fargo Force for an intense face-off Saturday. Fargo wasted no time, scoring in the first 2 minutes of the period as Mikey Essimont slaps it into the back of the net, Saints down 1-0. With just under 2 minutes left in the first, Zach Yon slides it in past Saints goalie Gavin Nieto to snag a 2-0 lead. Saints fight back with William Lagesson fires it from deep left to get on the board. Then, Shane Cavanaugh wraps around the Force's goalie to pass it in to Trey Dodd for the one-timer. Game tied at 2. The Smith brothers, or should we call them the Smash brothers, attack the goal to leave the Saints a 3-2 lead. Dubuque's final goal comes from Dylan Gambrell, who loses his balance and slides the pack into the back of the net. Saints win 4-2. They're back on the ice this Friday, hosting Green Bay. For tonight's Duke Play of the Week, we head back to San Jose Pool. Junior Elise Amo, competing in the 500 freestyle, comes down, and she's taking the race. She's won it. She's almost there, and would you look at that? She takes the win, and she beats it by less than a second. Let's take a look at that again. Wow, what a win for her. Finally, congratulations to the women's volleyball team for making the Iowa Conference Tournament. Their loss to Central last night concluded their season. That's everything in sports. Back to you.
We're just about out of time, but before we go, we need to reveal the winner of Yo So Sweet Trivia.
Here's a quick recap of the question. President Barack Obama is a Democrat. Before Obama, who was the last Democrat to inhabit the White House? Is it A, George W. Bush, B, George H.W. Bush, C, Ronald Reagan, or D, Bill Clinton? The answer is D, Bill Clinton.
Congratulations, Ashley Puddle. She is our winner tonight. Join us in 2 weeks for one last chance to get your free frozen yogurt.
And that's all we have tonight. The soccer match starts in 10 minutes, so head on over to the Rock Bowl to cheer the Duhawks on to victory.
If you can't make it to the game, you can catch the live sports broadcast on duhawks.com/live.
As always, stay tuned to myduhawk.com and follow us on Twitter at LCTV_news for the latest information.
Thanks for joining us.